hesitant to pray or hesitant even to ask someone if they want prayer, but I know that I don't know if I've ever had someone say, no, I don't want you to pray. And usually people are quite glad to know that you care. And in a situation like that's great. That's great. So are they're there again today, are they?
No, they're there
Friday and Saturday. Okay. Yeah. Good. Thank you. Recently, I had a bone density test done. And a bone density test is an x-ray of your bones, and it'll show how strong they are, how healthy they are, or they'll show if my bones are starting to get weak, if they're starting to get thin, and if they are, then I could be starting to get osteoporosis. On the outside, I think I look pretty healthy. I have no trouble walking, no trouble standing, I'm not breaking any bones. But I do have a few risk factors that could make me susceptible to osteoporosis. And the x-ray would show then if there are any changes starting in my bones now. And these changes are something that you can't see just looking at me. I can't tell just looking in the mirror at myself if something's changing in my bones. My doctor can't see by looking at me from the outside whether anything is happening inside. And this past week I had a call from the doctor's office and they told me that my bones are good. And I was glad to hear that because, like I said, you can't see inside from the outside. I didn't know what was going on. And it gives them a starting place as well, that if I have one in a few years from now, whether anything has changed. Tom Wright, who is an Anglican theologian, tells a story that when he was living in the Middle East, he was walking home from the church one day, and he was hungry, so he stopped and bought a chocolate bar. And he unwrapped the chocolate bar, and he broke off a piece to put it in his mouth. And as he went to stick it in his mouth, he looked down at it. And what he saw made him shout and drop it. He said, it was alive. Inside that chocolate bar, that perfectly ordinary chocolate bar, were hundreds of tiny wiggling worms. I was telling this to my kids, and Melanie, who loves chocolate, said, I don't, that almost makes me wonder if I want to have chocolate again. She said, I don't usually look before I stick it in my mouth. You can't always tell by looking at something what's on the inside. Someone may be crying inside, maybe because of a difficult situation, because of family struggles, marriage problems, maybe whatever. And yet they put on a cheerful face and a cheerful expression, and nobody knows. Maybe you do something for somebody. Maybe you're doing something really nice for somebody. You're helping somebody out. But you'd really rather be somewhere else. You'd rather be doing something else. Maybe you feel like you have to. And again, the motive is different than what you're actually doing. What you're feeling up inside doesn't match your actions on the outside. There's been a 17-year-old boy in the news this past week that I read of. He was taken into custody in Colorado after confessing to that he killed a 10-year-old girl. They shared a little bit about his family and his friends, what they said. His friends said how nice he was, that he joked all the time, he laughed a lot. He was very, very smart. In fact, 17 years old, and from the sounds of it, he was done high school, he was moving on, he was very smart. His friends said they never imagined that he could do something like that. They could see his outward appearance, but they couldn't see what was going on inside. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says, unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, we've talked about this word righteousness a number of times. It's been used in the scriptures as we've been going through the Sermon on the Mount. Righteousness means the beginning of the word is right. It's right living. It also carries the sense of justice, being just, righteous. In God's kingdom, there's righteousness when everything happens as it should, when everything is shaped by the will of God. That's righteousness. Now, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, they were the religious leaders of that day, and they tried to be very good. They honestly were trying to follow all the laws and so that they could make themselves presentable to God, that they would be good enough for God. But Jesus says it's just actions. It hadn't connected to their heart. And we've talked about this in the last few weeks, that the change needs to happen at the very core of our being. our heart and our mind, and when our relationship with God, when it comes and touches the very core of our being, then our actions will line up out of that. And Jesus talks about a new relationship, a new way of relating to other people, and we talked about that last week and the week before, how we will act in our relationships, how we will treat other people. And now, as we move into chapter 6, he shifts to our relationship with God and gets more to that heart attitude, that our motives, as we live our lives before God. In Matthew 6:1, it says, "Be careful not to do your acts of righteousness before people, to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven." Now, I don't know if Jesus ate chocolate back in his day, if they even had chocolate. But Jesus did know, and God knows, that people can look one way on the inside, and they can look different, they can look rotten, they can be full of worms. They can look one way on the outside, and they can look another way. They can be rotten, full of worms, whatever, on the inside. And Matthew 6 shares what it looks like to live a life that is solid chocolate all the way through. I'm going to invite the youth to come and read the verses with us from Matthew chapter 6 now.
Matthew 6:1, "Take care, don't do your good deeds publicly to be admired, because then you will lose the reward from your Father in heaven."
When you give a gift to someone in need,
don't shout about it as the hypocrites do, blowing trumpets in the synagogue and streets to call attention to their acts of charity. I assure you, they have received all the rewards they will ever get.
But when you give to someone,
don't tell your left hand what your right hand is doing. Give your gifts in secret, and your Father who knows all secrets will reward you.
And now about prayer. When we pray,
don't be like the hypocrites who love to pray publicly on street corners and in the synagogues where everyone can see them.
Oh God, I thank you that I am not like other people, robbers, crooks, adulterers, sinners, or heaven forbid, like these people here. Sweep arm. I fast twice a week and tithe on my income. Give it to the church.
I assure you that is all the reward they will ever get.
But when you pray,
go away by yourself, shut the door behind you, and pray to your Father secretly. Then your Father, who knows all secrets, will reward you.
When you pray,
don't babble on as other people. On and on as people of other religions do. They think their prayers are answered only by repeating their words again and again. Don't be like them, because your Father knows exactly what you need even before you ask him.
Pray like this.
Our Father in heaven, may your name be honored.
May your kingdom come soon.
May your will be done here on earth just as it is in heaven.
Give us food for today.
Forgive us our sins, just as we have forgiven those who have sinned against us.
Don't let us yield to temptation, but deliver us from the evil one.
If you forgive those who sin against you, your Heavenly Father will forgive you.
But if you refuse to forgive others, your Father will not forgive your sins.
And when you fast,
don't make it obvious as the hypocrites do, who try to look pale and unkempt, so people admire them for their fastings. I assure you that this is the only reward they will ever get.
But when you fast,
comb your hair and wash your face. Then no one will suspect you are fasting. Expect your Father, who knows what you are doing in secret, and your Father, who knows all secrets, will reward you.
Thank you, guys. You're great. Jesus talks about three acts of righteousness that show that we belong to God. He talks about giving and praying and fasting. The assumption is there that we do those three things. He says, when you give, when you pray, when you fast. And each time in each of those three situations, Jesus says that we are not to do it like the hypocrites. Now, hypocrites is a word that Jesus uses often to describe the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. Hypocrite means play acting. It means that you are doing a good deed as if you were performing. And I hope that you kind of got that idea through what Taylor did. People are watching you. You're doing it for an audience. And you're waiting for them to praise you. Jesus says, don't do it like the hypocrites. Not to do it for praise, but you do it with the right motivation. Joyfully and willingly and generously. For God, not for people, to praise you. And Jesus says that if your motivations, if your heart is right as you do these three acts of righteousness, giving and praying and fasting, then you will be rewarded from him. But if they aren't coming from the proper attitude, from the proper motives, then our spirituality, our very relationship with God, is all for show. It's like it's rotten. It's like it's full of worms. And the only reward that we will receive is from people. The first one, we want to just look at these quickly. The first one is when you give. Now, in Acts chapter 5, there's a story of Ananias and Sapphira that you may remember. Ananias and Sapphira sell their land. And they bring the money to the disciples for the use of the church. And they pretend that they're giving all of it. But yet they hold some back. They're giving with the wrong motive. They want to look good. This is all of the land. We sold all of our land, and we're giving it all to you. And yet they didn't. They held it back. In Deuteronomy 15, God says to the people that they're not to be hard-hearted or tight-fisted toward their fellow brothers. Rather, they're to be generous without a grudging heart. They're to be open-handed and to give freely to the poor and the needy. And Jesus says, don't do it with trumpets blasting so that everyone sees what's going on. Now, there's no evidence that in that day a trumpet blasted. It's kind of like us saying that we're tooting our own horn. I did really well yesterday, kind of like that type of thing. I'm tooting my own horn so that everyone sees what I'm doing. It's like saying, like publicly giving $10 million to the hospital just for the sole purpose that they will name a wing after you. Now, I'm not saying that if people are acknowledged for a gift that it's always wrong motives, but if the reason that you're giving is just so that you can be acknowledged, just so you can have your name on a wing, it's good to look at a heart then and see why are you actually giving. Jesus says, rather do your giving in secret. Bless people secretly. Be spontaneous. Find joy in giving without receiving praise or thanks. I read an article and from the Mennonite Foundation of Canada this week, and it said that we believe that our God is generous and that our generosity is a reflection of God's character. I thought, that is so true, so powerful, that our generosity is a reflection of God's character. Giving is an act of worship that proves that our words of faith are true. Generosity is faith in action. I thought that was really good. Giving is our grateful response to what God has done for us and what he's given us. And we will receive a reward. We are promised a reward, but the reward will be from God. Now, it doesn't say in any of these what the reward will be. The reward may be in knowing God more, in our relationship with God deepening. It may be other things, but we know that there will be a reward, and there's a sense that that reward will be now, and it will also be in eternity. What the reward is isn't the thing that's important. But Jesus says, do your spiritual acts of righteousness as God intends, and that you will reap a harvest of God's blessings. He goes on to say the same thing with prayer. Jesus says, when you pray, don't do it for show. Don't do it to be seen. Don't do it to impress other people. And in Luke 18, you have the story of the Pharisee who came to the temple and said the grand prayer that we heard from Taylor. Praise a very arrogant prayer, praising himself. And if you look further in that story, you'll see the prayer is not accepted by God. I don't know if any of you have heard on YouTube, Pastor Joe Nelms prayed a strange pre-prayer race, he prayed a strange prayer at a NASCAR race in Nashville, Tennessee in 2011. He prayed for the Mighty Machines, GM Performance Technology, RO7 Engines, Sunoco Racing Fuel, Goodyear Tires. He prayed for his smoking hot wife, and he ended his prayer with boogity, boogity, boogity. Quite a showy prayer, and it's interesting when you watch it, just to see the reaction of the drivers and the people as they are listening to him pray. Prayer was very important in Jewish life. They had fixed times of prayer, and they had special prayers that were said at different times of the day. Some people, not just the Jews, but others as well, would call attention to themselves by praying very long prayers in public places, such as street corners. Some would babble on, and they would use the same words over and over again. And it was like they thought it was a magic portion or a magic formula, that if you say just the right words, and believe me, there have been times I wished this was true, that if you say the right words in the right way, that you can almost like you can twist God's arm, and that God will do what you want him to do. Rather, Jesus says, go to your room, shut the door. Now, I don't believe that he's necessarily saying that you have to do your praying all in private. But he's saying that to pray, the sole intent of our prayer is communication with God, communion with God. We need to pray sincerely. And it says in those passages that God already knows what we need. And then he offers us a sample prayer, kind of a foundation or a guide of how to pray. Not that we are supposed to pray just the Lord's Prayer, but it gives us an example of how to pray, a framework. Pray to God our Father for his purposes, that his will be done. Pray to God our Father not only for my needs, but for our needs, for provision, for pardon, and for protection. And it ends that section by saying, take to heart, that says we forgive, that we are also forgiven. Third one is when you fast. In Corinthians 14, Paul talks about people who prayed their spiritual gifts in front of other people trying to show how good they are. When the Pharisees fasted, everyone knew it. They would fast twice a week. They would walk around wearing garments of sackcloth, and they would sprinkle ashes on their head. They would look glum and sad so that everyone could see what they were doing. They wanted people to notice how religious they were. Jesus says, look normal. He says, wash your face. Don't let people know what you're doing. Fasting is a way to deny yourself, to show a sincerity, especially when you're praying for something that is really heavy on your heart. Fasting is a way of denying and saying, God, my heart is connecting to you. My cry is coming to you. Food doesn't even matter to me. This is so important to me. It takes place between you and God. As I read this week, I thought, what does this have to do with us today? Why, first of all, why did Jesus focus on giving and on fasting and on prayer? Well, in Jesus' day, these things were very important to the people. They believed somewhat that they would earn favor with God. It was almost like earning your salvation through fasting and giving and praying. But what about us today? And I've wondered, what would Jesus have highlighted today? Would he have highlighted those same three things if he was here with us today? Or would he have highlighted something else? Most of us don't pray very often in public. For most of us, I would suggest that our giving is very private already. Ed, you're the treasure. You take it in. But most of us, we don't know. Nobody knows what we're giving. We do it relatively privately. I'm assuming that most of us probably don't fast very often either. So what does this have to do with us today? They're all three good things. They're good practices. They're something that I feel is very important in connecting with who God is. And in Matthew 23:26, Jesus said, the religious leaders of that day, they are full of greed and self-indulgence. On the outside, they appear as righteous, but on the inside, they are full of hypocrisy and wickedness. They're rotten at the core. It's like having worms. And the whole problem is motivation. It's our heart attitude. And in contrast, in these scriptures, Jesus calls us to act quietly without seeking public praise, trying not to elevate ourselves above other people. Our giving and our praying and even fasting will flow out of a relationship with Jesus Christ. And Jesus said, the greatest among you will be your servant, Matthew 23, verse 11. We are to worship God with a true spirit and with our actions matching what's going on inside. In Matthew 23, verse 23, Jesus says, you give, but you have neglected the most important matters of the law, mercy, justice, and faithfulness. And I had to think as I read that verse that how much easier it is sometimes to pray and to give and even to fast than actually to take the time to find out what's going on, to get involved, to step in, and to do what it takes. It takes time. It can take extra money. It can take strength, and it can be a lot of work sometimes. So it can be easier just to pray and just to give. But the very heart of who God is someone who is generous. And God came into our world, stepped into our world through Jesus Christ. He didn't just stay from afar, but he came right into. And so for us, praying and fasting and giving are very important, but it's also important that we see what needs to be done as well and to get involved. True acts of faithfulness will focus our attention on God. They will expand our vision of what God can actually do, even through me, even through you, and it will expand and seek the good of the community around us. The Bible tells us over and over and over again that God's heart is especially towards the poor, the widow, the orphan, the suffering. His heart is especially towards them. And when we are generous, we are reflecting the generosity of our God who has given so much for us. When we pray, prayer is powerful. Prayer is powerful. It's one of the most powerful things that we can do. God hears us when we pray. He desires that we pray. He desires that we come into his presence. Spend time with him. He delights when we pray. Denying yourself by fasting is a way that we humble ourselves before God, that we show God that the concerns that are on our heart are more important than food. It's nothing to do with the acts in and of themselves, but it's that heart attitude that's our motives when we pray, when we give, when we fast. Jesus says to be so eager to love and praise and please God that we will do everything for his eyes alone, that we will do it for his eyes alone. Give and pray and fast freely and generously and faithfully because we're followers of Jesus Christ, because we love God, and because we love our neighbor. And God invites us to live a life in which our insides match our outward actions, where there are no worms, where we're not rotten inside. And he says, as we focus on God who sees in secret, then God will bless us as well. May we be solid chocolate all the way through. Will you pray with me? God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for your word that challenges us. What are our motives? What are our attitudes? Why are we really doing something? And your word that even says that if we're doing it out of wrong motives, out of wrong attitude, that it's not really even accepted. It's done. It's good. But it's not even accepted before God. Lord, I pray that as we look at these scriptures, that you will challenge us for what that means for us today. What are the areas where we have to check our attitudes and our motives today? Lord, I pray that you would give us glimpses of you and of what you've done and what you continue to do, that our generosity may reflect your generosity. Lord, that we would delight to give, that we would delight to pray, that you would even call us to fast, that you would burden our hearts, that we would fast as well. And Lord, there are other things, but I just pray that as we have looked at these words this morning, that you will look at the attitudes of our hearts And Lord, I pray that our motives, our attitudes may be right before you, that we do these things to honor and glorify you, for your name to be praised. Lord, as we go this week, I pray for opportunities to give in different ways, opportunities to pray. Lay on our heart, O God, the things that burden your heart. Even burden us, O God, that we may decide we want to fast. But give us opportunities to share through our actions, through our deeds. Open our eyes, O God, to see people the way you see them. And Lord, I pray that as we do these things, that we may sense the warmth, even when nobody has a clue what we've done, the warmth of knowing that you love us and that you are pleased with us. Thank you, O God, for that it's through us that you choose to bless our community, our world. Just use us for your honor and glory, I pray, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.